like influence the global picture. Okay, so lots of facts about sheaves can be understood at the level of stalks, and this isn't true for pre-sheaves in general. We'll see why. In particular, something like the sections and morphisms are determined by their stalks, and the property of a morphism being an isomorphism can also be verified at the level of stalks. Okay, so we'll start with the simple proposition. Which is that a section of a sheaf of sets is determined by its terms. So what do I mean by this? That is, the natural map F, so this is our sheaf, into collection of stalks, roll U, okay, so that's not right, I want some specific collection of sections. The natural map is injective. Right. Vakil doesn't prove this, leaves it as an exercise. I'll try to prove that. Some other things. Right. So we see what this thing means, right? That I can embed my collection of my sections into this collection of stalks, and somehow deduce information about this thing from this thing. Isn't that nice? Super nice. Okay. So consider the map. I'm going to call it omega. And this is a map from U into our collection of stalks. And what do we do? What's the natural map? Let's see. So if I take F from here, could you guess where I'm going to map it to? Huh? Suggestions? I'm just going to do this, right? For P and U, that totally works, because we're iterating over all elements P inside U, and each of P. Well, I mean, this is an equivalence class, so I better draw it like this, right? But in particular, FU is a natural representative in every single. Stalk that we have. Okay, so so suppose that for some f and g in fu, we have the identity like this. Right. So now let's try to understand why this.
I think you switched from omega to.
Oh, God. Yes, you're right. You're right. In fact, I'm going to call it psi, because I changed my mind. I like this one better. Okay, so then. Well, let's try to understand, what does this thing say, right? Well, just by definition, we see that we have this. Yeah. So this is P inside U copy inside you. Right, but what does it mean? This, which in turn means that FU is equivalent to GU in FP for all P in U. Correct? Right? I'm gonna. Should I? Would you like me to recall the definition of FP, everyone? Or everyone? Does everyone remember what that is? Right? So, are we good? Okay, sure. For all P in U. So thus, so for each P in U, so there's so for each P in U, there exists some open neighborhood WP containing which is open, contains P such that the restriction U to WP, F is the same thing as the restriction of U WP G. Whew. What happens next? Amazingness. Amazingness. Yes. So observe that WPs is an open cover of U. And then use the identity axiom. Can you see this? Okay. To conclude that F and G are the same. What I mean by sheaf of sets? Why do I need it to be a sheaf of sets? So I would say that sheaf of sets is the most general construction that you can think of, right? So I think that if this is true for sets, then this is going to be true for anything, in fact, right? This is just the most general thing that you can think of, right? But you need to have some kind of target category, so might as well be it sets. Okay, does that make sense? All right. So remark. So, as I mentioned, this is not true for pre-sheaves in general, but for some pre-sheaves, this is true. For which pre-sheaves is this true? Those that have identity axiom is going to be true. So my remark is that this is true even for separated pre-sheaves. Right? Separated pre-sheaf is the one that satisfies identity axiom but doesn't satisfy the globality. Right? So that totally works. What else is there? Oh yeah, and the next remark was that it is independent of the target category of F. So thank you very much. You're thinking ahead. Okay, the next thing. So for general pre-sheafs. It's fine. Let's move to the next, to the definition. So suppose F is a sheaf, or a separated pre-sheaf, of abelian groups. On X and S, so on X and S is a global section. Section of F. We define the support of S. As follows. So it is the collection of all points inside X such that, oh God, so if we take the germ of S at P, it's non-zero in FP. That makes sense? The germ. Yeah. Of S at P, right? So what is it, right? So, right. So you have this natural map from I don't know, from FU to FP, right? Given by so if you take S, you map it to the equivalence class, like that, right? That's what it is. And so what I mean over here is that this image, this is non-zero. Cool. Make sense?
Yeah.
I think it does. Right. Okay. All right. I'm learning while I'm speaking. Okay. As you may notice. So this is the support. And proposition. What do we expect the support to be? The support of S is a closed subset of X. Proof. How do we prove this? Suggestions.
Show that it's open.
Yay! Yes. Amazing. Yes. Let's show that X minus the support of S is open. Well, how do we do that? Well, if you look at it, then if you look at the elements in here, so take P and X minus the support of S, right? So then we have that SP is zero, but the thing about this is that it's going to be zero not only at P, but at some open neighborhood of P, right? And then you unite over all such neighborhoods, right? This union of open sets must be the whole thing, because we union over all P's, right? So it's open. The complement is closed. Done. Should I formalize this? Maybe. No. Okay. I'm gonna be lazy today. Yes.
Thinking on that SP.
Mm-hmm.
Because S is a shape. S is global section. It's
global section means that instead of U, you have X.
Yeah, exactly. But SP, what's the germ of F?
So what is SP, right? So I take S, and it's just the image under this natural map. That's what it is. That makes sense? So it's an image in FP. All good? Right. Yeah, so I guess I should have written down the definition in case if people forgot what it is, right? So remember what just remember what FP is, right? This is a collection of you have a section F. It is defined over U, right? And then what is this thing? So U is open. P is inside U, and F is a section over U. So that's one thing, but you mod out and say that FU is equivalent to GV in the case that there exists W, which is containing both U and V, such that F restricted to W is the same thing as G restricted to W. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So this would mean this non-zero would mean there exists for every open set it's non-zero. The restriction of S. For every open set.
Yes. Yeah. That. Yeah. Exactly. So, for every. For its non being, yeah. So if you localize, no matter how you localize, it's going to be non-zero, you know.
At some point,
yeah. Looks like it's what it is. Okay, let's proceed. And now we're coming to the definition of compatible germs. When I saw this definition first, I stared at it for 20 minutes. Sorry, but. To me, it really took some time to understand what is going on there. I can't say that I understand it completely, but maybe you can help me out, or Nick, for that sake. You know, we'll rely on you. Let's see. So now, let me make the following comment. So from the fact that we can take FU. And we can embed it inside the product of FPs for P inside U. The natural question arises, what elements have preimages? We ask a natural question. Yeah. What elements lie in the preimage of Psi? Right. So what can we target here? Right?
In the image.
Yes. What elements do have preimage? Which means that what elements are in the image? Right. What elements lie in the image? And so we're coming to the definition of a compatible collection of germs. So let's see what that is. Definition: an element product of germs, all P in U, in product of stalks, consists of compatible germs if. So, for all P inside U, there is some representative So it's a pair, right? So S tilde P, this is confusing as hell. This is a section, not a germ. This is a section associated to a germ. Okay, that's what it is. This is inside F of UP. Now I'm going to tell you what is UP, right? So it's a pair, right? Because it's an element, it's an element in FP, right? So this is UP open in U, like that. For SP, and where of course P should be inside UP, and this is inside U, such that the germ of S tilde P at Q inside UP is SQ for all Q in UP. So I'll give you 20 minutes. Stare at that. Let me formulate an alternative definition, and then maybe we can, we will discuss it. What does that mean? Let's. So, equivalently, there is an open cover UI of U and sections FI in FUI such that if P is inside UI, then SP, so is the germ of FI at P. Okay. So now let's try to understand what is going on here. Right. So let's focus on the first definition. So we have this collection of compatible germs, and now these are all just equivalence classes, right? And now I'm telling you that each SP can be written in this form, right? This specific form. Right, so I can write it down as what? So S tilde P and UP, right? That's what it is. Okay? So this is the same thing as, I guess I'll put equivalence classes over here. This is like this. And now here's what's going on. That if I'm going to take this particular section and I'm going to localize it, look at this section near some neighborhood of Q inside UP, right? So I take some Q. I'm going to result in some other element of this product, right? So that's what's going on. They're all connected between each other. Whew. Does that make sense? It does. Fantastic. Oh. It's not as bad as I thought. Now I'm trying to understand why this is also, why these two definitions are equivalent, right? Let's think about that too. There is an open cover of U, and we have a collection of sections defining over each open cover.
This UP will be your open cover here, I guess.
These what? UPs are our open cover, okay? And I guess, and S tilde P's are precisely our sections right there. Okay, question? Okay. Okay. Whew. Are we good? All right. Now let's see why this is good. Let's see why the collection of compatible germs, why is it nice? So proposition. Any choice of compatible germs for a sheaf of sets, or whatever you like, over U is the image of a section of F over U. Right? So these are. Exactly. Yeah. The beauty of those is that you can, right? You can glue them. Can you? I think you can. We'll figure it out. Proof. Right, but those are precisely the elements that we're target by C. Okay? Huh? Oh, that's a good point. Right. So, okay, I also noted that. Let's think about it. So at this point, it tells us that they're certainly in the image. But the question is, are those the only ones targeted? I guess we did not address that. That's a good point, right?
That's
the problem. And actually, I noticed this in Bakil's notes. He also did not say if and only if. He says that we just completely classified. He did say this in the notes. So I am wondering, maybe there's some obvious fact about, say, if the germ is non-compatible in some sense, then it just can't be targeted. We can think about that, or I'll think about that,
so, and
I'll.
Yeah, you could just look at the image of it.
Your pre-image, you just put that for every SP.
So the whole image is because of this.
Yeah, you can do that. That's the easy way to do it. Yeah.
So could you please repeat it? Could you please say it out loud again?
It says if you look at this definition.
Okay. Yes.
And then your image of some section, and this section as your F.
Right? Uh-huh. Yeah. Right.
In some sense, it says, the proposition says that this condition sort of trivializes it. You could always do it on one.
Yeah.
All right. So let me prove this. And, Before the talk, Nick came to help me out with the sheafification and some proofs about it. Is that the way? And I understand that I overcomplicate things because when I try to prove stuff, I look at the very definition and I just start from the very very bottom. That's how I think about things. So that's how I'm going to prove that proposition as well, if you don't mind. Probably you already. It looks like what you said. You already did. You already proved it. Okay. So let's see. So let's take a collection of germs, and let's assume that this collection is compatible. This is compatible germs. Well, then for each P inside U, there exists a neighborhood UP inside U, open, and containing P. And the section inside, it's a section defined over UP such that the SP is equivalent to S tilde P UP. Okay? Okay. Right. So if I want to say if I want to put equality, I better put the these brackets over here. What is the question again? This is in FP, right?
I was saying they sort of have a different type. One is a section, the other is a term.
This one moment. No. One moment. No. So this is the germ, right? So this is an. Oh, I guess I get what you're saying. So I should do like it should do it like this.
Yes.
Awesome. Thank you very much for pointing this out. Good. Okay. Now, what happens next? So let's. This is just basically I'm stating the definition. So, and for each Q, which I take from this neighborhood UP, we have that the germ of S tilde P at Q is SQ. So then, note that. Well, UP is an open cover. Is an open cover of U. We now have for each P inside for each P inside U. Some S tilde P inside F of UP. Oh, I just repeat myself. Now suppose that for some P and Q inside U, I have UP intersect UQ being non-empty, right? If they're empty, then the next statement is going to be trivial. Right? Then I say, what do I say? Well, if I'm going to restrict my sections of this, if I'm going to look at the restriction of my section S tilde P and S tilde Q to UP intersect UQ, they're going to coincide. Guess what I'm going to do next? Glue. Right. Then, so if I take this section restricted to UP intersect UQ, this is going to be the same thing as if I take section S tilde Q and restrict it to UP intersect UQ. Why is that true?
Yeah, you have to defend this.
Huh?
I said you do have to defend this claim.
Okay.
Does that come?
Hmm?
But isn't this just the definition of being in the same
one moment. So to something smaller. So I guess it's not UP intersect UQ, but I should take some W inside UP intersect UQ.
Yeah.
Good
but
point.
But you can use the identity axiom here. So you can open cover the intersection with neighborhoods of points in the at every point in the intersection at which you have agreement. So it's like meta restriction.
It's clear that this must work because it's the only argument that could possibly.
Okay. Now I see. So I guess what I should have what the error here right is that like, it looks like it's correct after all. But what I needed to say is that there is some W inside UP and UQ, and it can inside UP intersect UQ. And if I localize, enough, then this should be true on W. But then I can take my W's to be my to be this new open cover, and I can glue from W's in that sense, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Use the identity axiom.
Can I just say that by the identity axiom, okay? Thank you.
If you want to know the actual argument,
let's. We can spend some time thinking about it. I'm also interested, right? I can't say that I'm 100% comfortable with that stuff. I'm just learning the terminology. So let's see. We took UP and UQ, right? What are we working on?
Every point inside the intersection, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
For every point.
Every point is a little neighborhood inside the intersection.
Okay. Oh, I see how it could go.
Okay. All right. Good. You see more than I do. Trust me. Right, so this is true because the germ of S tilde P at Q, which is located in here, is SQ, right?
And then you can get your open neighborhood for every point they agree on. And then once you have the cover, then you use the identity axiom by the identity axiom.
Okay.
Wow.
I'm gonna. I'm just gonna finish this. We can now use the globality axiom. The axiom, right? Because now that we have all these sections which agree on these intersections, they must agree on top, right? Right. I'm embarrassed to put this video online.
And why is the image of this glued thing equal to the set of compatible germs?
Why is the image of this glued thing is equal to the set of compatible germs? I didn't answer that question, right? Well, let's think about it.
It's not hard.
I understand that it's not hard, right? So you take this thing, and then you basically consider. What is it? You map. Okay. So you glue it, and you get some new. You get some new section, essentially, right? You get some section F in FU, and then what happens is you're gonna map your F. You map your F to this product of SPs, right? Well, I mean, you should have put like I don't know. S hat, whatever. so this is what's happening, right? And now you just have to show that for each P, S hat P, and SP, they coincide.
SP have the same term because they coincide on
UP. Exactly. Yes. Yeah. So you can easily show that S hat P is. It's the same thing as SP that we had before, right? Because they agree on these UPs. Okay?
Because you consider them equivalent if they are
agree.
Open.
Yes.
So
yes, exactly. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Okay. So you're saying that I could just do this, right? So this is the equivalence class of FUP. Mm-hmm. That's what you're telling me. But we, right? Okay. Are we good? Let's move to the next. thing. So now, so this proposition, of course, is not true. What proof? Proof of what?
You started.
Okay. I moved. I got it. Let's move to the next. So now we're going to talk about. We're now going to look at morphisms, morphisms of stalks and things like morphisms of these sets, these products of compatible germs. Okay. Let's see. Proposition. If phi 1 and phi 2 are two morphisms from a presheaf to a sheaf, from a presheaf, let's call it F, to a sheaf G with any target category you like. That induce the same map on each stalk. Then phi 1 is the same as phi 2. Right, so here we use the result that we proved before, that if you have a morphism from a presheaf to a sheaf, then it induces this natural map from one stalk to the other. That makes sense? So let me write this down. How that works? See. So this is first thing. You have some morphism, let's call it phi, which maps into here. Good. Now we have this, and here we have this. Okay? So this diagram commutes. That's what it tells you. As long as G is a sheaf, that's all that you require. Right. What are the arrows? Let's see. So I take F in here, right? So over here I'm gonna map phi of it. But this thing I'm just gonna map it to my natural equivalence class. That makes sense? All right. And so over here, of course, I'm gonna get phi of F. I believe that's the case.
And somehow this is well defined.
Yeah, it's because phi depends, phi restricts the mutual restriction.
Yeah.
You have a map phi for every open, and then you can pick an open and apply it, and it'll work.
Ugh. All right. So now, of course, you see because this thing. Oh no! Actually, maybe I'll stay here, right? So now you see, because this thing commutes, I guess it's natural to say that this thing should commute as well, right? Because you have this commutative thing going on for each germ here and here, right? So you can so it's the same thing for the product spaces. This makes sense to me. I don't think that there's any details in showing that, right? Right. So now this is the picture that we have. Okay. So this is true. And what we have is that, and now we have phi 1 and phi 2 over here, right? And it so happens that they induce, once again, they induce these two maps. But in fact, these maps are exactly the same thing. So let me call them, what did I call them here? The product of FPIs, right? this is a product of FP1, and this is a product of phi P2. That's what it is, right? So, and these are the same. Okay? So now, to verify this, it's pretty straightforward, right? So this is the map C that we had before, and this is the map, let's call it CF, CG, right? And you see what's gonna play the major role here. It's the injectivity of C, right? This diagram commutes. So now you have one image for two things, and that's why these two have to be the same. Does that make sense? I think so too. Right? Good. And let me, at the end, I'm just going to state what he calls a tricky exercise. And I am tricky enough not to do it. So this is just, I'm just going to state a theorem, which is a morphism of sheaves. Of sets is an isomorphism if and only if it induces an isomorphism of stalks. No proof.
The next speaker.
Sorry. Right. Oh, it's the end. Oh, I wanted to prove it, but it's the end of the lecture. Oh, goddamn. Right. So I think that's it for me. So I also wanted to, I thought that I'm going to get into sheafification, but then I thought about it and decided that I won't do it. But the next thing that is going to happen is that we're going to look at this process of where you take the pre-sheaf and you construct a sheaf from it. And we'll see that the way you construct, the way you do this construction, I'll mention a couple of words about that. So the way you make this construction is by taking your pre-sheaf F, mapping it to a sheaf. But how does this thing define? The way we're going to define it is precisely the set of compatible germs. So we're going to see, so there's some SPs inside FP. This P is in U, and this thing is compatible. Right. And at this point, there's tons of things to verify, which Nick tried to help me out with. And he failed not because he doesn't know the stuff, but because I don't know, I'm not that proficient in that subject. But so there's tons of things to verify. Verify that this is a sheaf. Verify that this is unique up to isomorphism. Verify that it has a specific universal property. So there's many things that one has to check. But it's a pretty cool construction. And of course, something like if you recall the constant pre-sheaf, right? This very natural thing. And if you try to sheafify it. You'll get precisely the constant sheaf that we talked about, this set, this collection of locally constant functions. That's what is happening. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.